Greetings and welcome to this discussion entitled Introduction to Buddhism. The reason we are having this discussion is because there are so many misconceptions regarding our noble religion. Although 1/5 of the world's population is Buddhist, there are so many practices which to us seem totally against the teaching of the enlightened Buddha himself. As a result of this, many intelligent people, usually young people, have turned away from Buddhism, claiming that it is full of superstition, that it is out of date, and that it has no relevance to modern living. So we thought it would be necessary for us to have a discussion to find out what really the Buddha taught and what Buddhism is all about. We're also concerned that there are many cults and many bizarre practices that have come up recently, all in the name of Buddhism. And this has given Buddhism a very bad image. So we have decided to invite a very prominent Buddhist scholar in the person of our most venerable Dr. Dhammananda Nayaka Thera, whom we usually call Chief Reverend. Our Chief Reverend has been in this country for more than 40 years preaching the Buddhist teachings to people. He is also well known for having introduced a contemporary understanding of what the Buddha taught 2,500 years ago. He is well known all over the Buddhist world for his numerous speeches and publications. Also in this discussion, we have invited a number of very prominent Buddhist leaders in this country. Please allow me to introduce them to you. First, we have Mr. Tan Teck Beng, who is the president of the Buddhist Missionary Society, which was founded about 30 years ago. Then, on his left, we have Mr. Ng Hong Pao, advisor to the Malaysian Buddhist Association. Mr. Ang Chu Hong, advisor to the Young Buddhist Association of Malaysia. And Dr. Kumarasiri, a Vice President of the World Fellowship of Buddhists. I am Vijay Samaravikrama and I am a member of the Sasana Abhivudhivadana Society in the Brickfields Buddhist Vihara in Kuala Lumpur. The discussion that we are going to have will be divided into three parts. The first part will be entitled, Why Religion? The second part, What is Buddhism? And the third part, Buddhist practices and beliefs. We hope and we know that our most venerable chief will be able to enlighten us on all these topics, and we will have a much better understanding of what Buddhism really is. Now, without wasting any more time, it is a privilege and honor to call the first member of the panel, Dr. Kumarasiri, to ask his first question. Dato.
Thank you very much, Brother Vijaya. Most Venerable Nayaka Mahathera, this is indeed a great privilege and honor for us to be able to be with you this morning and to share with you your wisdom and insights into different aspects of Buddhism. Let me begin with your eminence kind permission with a fundamental question on this topic of why religion, and that is, what is religion to start with? And a corollary to that fundamental basic question is, what is the genesis of this thing we call religion, or how did religion arise in the first place?
Thank you very much for inviting me to come and participate here in this religious discussion. And your question is a very interesting subject, because there are various ways for us to interpret this word religion. I think all of you know the Latin word religio, pronounced as religion in the English language, but the original meaning of the Latin word is binding. But when Christianity accepted this word, they introduced as religion by giving a meaning, a system of worshipping, praying, and belief in God, and binding and rebinding to God. And that is why this word religion has become a very popular word. Later, the followers of all the other religions also used the same word religion. Then another question arises. Is Buddhism a religion? If the real meaning of word religion is belief in God or worshipping God, we cannot say actually the Buddha's teaching of Buddhism as religion. But if we give a wider interpretation to this word, religion means a righteous way of life for human beings to cultivate, to find out the purpose of life and the liberation from physical and mental sufferings. Then we can accommodate that word religion into Buddhism. On the other hand, why this word religion appeared in the man's mind? According to the various observations, people say, at the beginning, when people had various kinds of fear, suspicion, insecurity feeling, who could not understand the nature or the natural phenomenon, they thought there must be some sort of unknown, supernatural, powerful force. By worshipping or praying, they thought that they will be able to get rid of such disasters or destructions and problems that they had to face. That is how people started this word religion, and as a system of worshipping, and later enlarged, elaborated, explained in various ways.
Thank you, Venerable Sir, for that very sharp introduction to what religion is. And you can already begin to see that Buddhism does not really fit into this description of religion. Right? And there's another problem that really bothers us, and maybe we could ask Mr. Tan Teck Beng to ask the next question. Mr. Tan.
Chief Reverend, today there is a tremendous resurgence of interest in religion in the world, all over the world. Many people believe that religion is man-made. Now, with the tremendous advances in science and technology, they seem to think that they can have all the pleasure and happiness in the world, what you want. Do you think that man really needs religion today?
Actually, not only religion, everything that exists in this world is created by the human mind. Although people believe that religion has come down from heaven, but many people maintain religion is discovered, introduced by the human mind. In the modern society, no doubt, people have developed their intellect. Intellectual aspect of human mind alone cannot serve the mankind. That intellect can become the most dangerous force which they can use for destructive purpose. Therefore, there must be something to guide, to give proper guidelines how to maintain human life, human intelligence, human dignity, humane qualities. So, modern scientific knowledge cannot contribute all these things. In fact, without religion, we can use the word religion. Without religion, human intelligence can destroy the whole world. Then, if the situation is not very favorable today, then what would be the situation if religion never existed? That means human behavior becomes worse than animals' way of life. Because when they added that intelligence without guiding properly, they can misuse and destroy the whole world. Therefore, we strongly believe without religion, science and technology cannot maintain the human life and the world and the peace and to carry on our life peacefully. Therefore, whatever may be the label of religion, because there must be some sort of religion for human being to practice.
Venerable sir, you have just highlighted the positive role of religion, and you have defined religion as a way of life in order to for us to cultivate ourselves. Now, on the other hand, Karl Marx has mentioned that religion is the opium of the peoples. What is your comment on this?
That's right. There are some reasons for him to mention that. By observing how people use religion, actually he does not want to accuse religion. But having seen how people use religion, he thought religion has become nuisance and religion has blindfolded mankind and human beings were misled and created fanatics, at the same time introduced superstitious belief and various ideas which disgrace human intelligence. On the other hand, since it is very emotional issue, when it is introduced, human beings take this very seriously. After that, violence, bloodshed, and discrimination, and various other problems started because of religion. There are people who are not belong to any religion, who do not believe in God or heaven or hell or karma or anything. But we can see in them some sort of gentleness. They behave as gentlemen although they have no religion. That means what we need is not the religious label but religious principle. Those who have no religion also observe, respect religious principles.
So do we need Buddhism?
Certainly.
In other words, religion is not necessarily an opium. It can also be a stimulant for our thoughts, for our behaviors.
Yes.
Most
Venerable Nayaka Mahathera, I think you brought out into perspective very
cogent points. First is that religion is not something that is being given or handed out from some unknown place of origin, but it is something that has developed from humankind. And that there is basically in the human psyche a need for spirituality and religion. And that's why this has developed through the evolution of humankind. Is that a correct assumption, or is there any other explanation to that, most venerable Chief Reverend?
When you observe further, we can define in this way. When human mind and intelligence started to develop, they could manage to maintain human dignity by introducing humane qualities such as kindness, compassion, unity, harmony, understanding, cooperation. All these are humane qualities. These qualities were not given by God or not come down from heaven. Realized by human beings according to their experience. Then they develop humanism. In that humanism, they develop more and more human intellect. Later, when the concept of God developed, they invited concept of God into humanism, then turned into religion. After that, they accepted very seriously and introduced that this is a message given by the God. It is our duty to accept and obey.
So God was brought in to justify morality.
That's right.
Right. And can I ask Mr. Hong Pao, do you have any questions?
Chief Reverend, I beg to have your indulgence maybe to repeat again what you have said just now. When we look at the events in the world around us, one can easily point a finger at religion as a cause of war, persecution and discrimination. So there are some critics even say that why don't we do away with religion?
And as just have
a lot of people make use of religion. In the name of religion, a lot of bad things have been done, isn't it? Would you mind to kindly enlighten us?
I cannot fully agree with your questions. But religion is not the main cause of all our problems and war and conflicts and violence and bloodshed. There are so many other sources. But people use religion knowing that it is very sensitive, that they can arouse feeling by using religion. After that, they maintain superiority complex and they introduce that their religion is the only true religion, then created some sort of fanatics, then
discrimination, misunderstanding, ridiculing, accusing, try to maintain some sort of very unpleasant situation by using the name of religion.
Most Venerable Chief Reverend, I am terribly excited with what you have explained just now about the humanizing aspect of religion, that it helps to humanize us and to make us what we are, human beings, the gentle creature from the savage origins. Now, there is another reflection on why religion, which often comes to my mind, and that is the element of making us calm. That I find, at least in my own reflection, that religion helps us to be a more calm, collected, mindful being. Is that an element of religion, or is it a byproduct of religion? May I have your wisdom on this, Most Venerable Chief Reverend?
Why religion is needed is only human beings follow a religion.
Reason is, human beings are the only living beings who can appreciate and understand religion. Others do not know. On the other hand, since human mind is very unreliable and
unpredictable
and very dangerous, therefore religion is needed. Take for instance cunningness, selfishness. These two qualities we cannot find in other living beings, just like in human beings. But without religion, science or technology or any other subject, it is impossible to train a human mind to live as real human being. Therefore, human beings need religion because of these two reasons. First reason, human mind can appreciate and understand religion. And the other aspect is, human mind is dangerous if there is no religion to guide that mind.
Reverend Sir, Buddhism has been described as a way of life. Do you like that description?
This interpretation was given by the Western scholars, since they don't like the word religion. But when we say a way of life, I think we lower the status of Buddhism. That is why I mentioned earlier, it must be a righteous way of life for human being to practice in order to find out the purpose of life and liberation.
The human mind, as you said just now, is a very dangerous, shall we say, organ, whatever it's called, in man. So I believe that in the mind there are always defilements and purities. We cannot say that a person is totally bad or totally good. So the religion, the role of religion is, I believe, is to make man perfect. So do you think it is possible for religion to do this nowadays, in this world today, with all the distraction, you know, and the attraction that science and technology bring about?
Well, human mind is the same. Because the Buddha says, Pabhasvaramidam dikkave chittam tanchako agantukehi upakkile sehi upakkirittam. At the initial stage, human mind is very pure. Later, when the faculties, senses develop, that human mind absorb or bring external objects into that mind and pollute the purity of the mind. And that polluted mind can be purified only through religion. There is no any other method. In the modern society, there are so many ways and means that they have introduced to arouse temptation, at the same time
the senses,
to arouse the animal nature of human mind. By nature we have animal nature, human nature. Also we can say we have divine nature. Here divine means sublime state. By nature we have. But certain forces suppress and certain forces arouse according to circumstances and way of life. So in the modern way of life, everything is being organized and introduced and exposed to arouse the senses and the pleasure and the temptation. That is why people are not interested to devote their time for religious practices, because they think whatever they want to do, religion say no, should not do. Therefore, they don't like religions.
Especially young people.
So, the modern cult trying to introduce religion in such a way to provide something what people need. Then they like it. That means deterioration, not the development. So we are developing our materialistic way of life, but degenerating the spiritual way of life because we have become slaves to our senses.
So we need religion to guide us on the path to purification.
Chuhong?
In other words, we are living in a sensuous world, in a materialistic world. And religion is trying to tell us not to live so materialistically or not so sensuously. Now, how do we balance our life? Because it seems the religion, according to what you have defined just now, is trying to tell us not to indulge in too much sensual pleasures, not to indulge in too much material enjoyment and things like that. Whereas we have the desire for this kind of things. So this conflict, how do we resolve this?
That is why Buddhism is called middle path. According to Buddhism, there are no restrictions that the followers should not enjoy their life. They can enjoy their life very reasonable way, respectable way, without harming and bluffing and swindling and cheating others. They can enjoy their sensual pleasures. On the other hand, the Buddha also mentioned that we should not suffer in the name of religion. We should not practice self-mortification by torturing our physical body in the name of religion, such as starving without taking food and suffering from sicknesses without taking medicine in the name of religion. The Buddha never encouraged this kind of practices. So without going to any of these two extremes, by leading a normal life in respectable way, we can cultivate our religious way of life to gain the perfection, to attain the final salvation.
Venerable Sir, earlier in our discussion, we have bombarded you with a lot of questions on the negative aspects of religion, and you have answered for them. Now, I believe there are also positive aspects of religion, some of which have already been mentioned by you earlier, especially those related to personal development. But I think on the overall human civilization, religion also contributed significantly to the overall advancement of human culture, especially in areas like music, architecture, literature, fine arts, and so on. This is especially so in India and many other Asian countries. Perhaps you can tell us further on the contribution of Buddhism to the area of culture, and how do we Buddhists look at culture and Buddhism?
Actually, this is a very interesting question for our younger generation. We must understand, as human beings, we have extraordinary feeling, which is called emotional feeling. This emotion we cannot find in other living beings in the same manner. If we do not entertain this emotion, what will happen? Human mind can become very aggressive, very violent, and can become skeptics, and also very stubborn.
This cultural way of entertainment, supported by religion, especially in India and China, contributed a lot to calm the human mind and get into religious way of life through these cultural practices. Therefore, culture or cultural practices promote religion, and religion support cultural practices to entertain human emotion, to maintain normal human way of life. Therefore, culture and religion are interrelated. If you are going to separate these two, what will happen? Religion become very dry subject. Dry philosophy or psychology, it won't last long. So we could manage to maintain this gentle religion for the last 2,500 years because of this relationship, our culture and religion combined together. In the Buddha's teaching, also it is mentioned, we can respect our culture, we can respect our tradition if they are not harmful, if they are meaningful, if they are significant. Buddhism encourages. Therefore, there is no contradiction between culture and religion.
Thank you, Reverend Sir, for reminding us that we can be human and Buddhist as well, because a lot of people don't get that important connection between life and Buddhism. And we have, I think, time for one more question.
May I?
Can I ask Hong Pao first and then...
Chief Reverend, I'm very impressed by your explanation between the relationship of culture and religion. But as at the beginning, Mr. Vijaya has said that a lot of misconceptions has arisen among the generation of today. So much so that so many young men and intellectuals do not want to go for religion. So, would you enlighten us how to practice the religious way of life, how to bring these people back to religion?
To answer that question, I think we had to concentrate more on Buddhist organizations,
yes.
Buddhist leaders, how to organize their religious activities without becoming some sort of dull or dry subject. There must be certain items, practices for young people also, very easily can come and participate and contribute something. Later, when their understanding, experience, maturity develop, they appreciate real religious way of life and slowly forget the other aspect. That is how, from childhood, in Buddhist countries, their parents bring up their children through these practices until they realize the real meaning of religion.
Thank you, Reverend. I think we have time for one last question, and I'll give that to Dato.
Thank you very much, Brother Vijaya. Most Venerable Nayaka Mahathera, recently I had the privilege, good fortune of having a discussion with a very prominent American doctor, and we were discussing on biofeedback therapy, and we went into religion, and since we are discussing why religion, he particularly emphasized that Buddhism is a medium which he uses to try and correct some of the ailments or illnesses that his patients has. And he bases this on this particular concept that in Buddhism, there is a recognition that a healthy body needs a healthy mind and a healthy mind needs a healthy body. In other words, there must be a harmonization of mind and body to be in a perfect or good state of being. And because there is disequilibrium or disharmony between mind and body, then we have all kinds of problems of insomnia, aches, diabetics, and depressions, and etc. What is your comment on this particular aspect of Buddhism as a religion?
I think the Buddha has given the answer directly to a discussion. He has said, when the body is sick, don't allow your mind also to be sick. You can maintain healthy mind although you are sick. Then you can influence your mental energy to overcome many of your sicknesses. When we maintain pure, healthy mind without allowing that mind to create tension and frustration, disappointment, then the mind gets the chance to relax and calm. After that, that calmed mind influences the glands of the body, brain cells, neurons, then blood circulation, hormone. After that, normalize the organs of the body. The mind is responsible. When the mind is upset, we can understand, we have experience also, immediate bad effect. Physically, we had to experience. So it clearly shows mind is responsible. Modern scientists as well as doctors believe more than 90% of our sicknesses actually are created by our mind due to polluted mind. When the mind is pure, then the whole system, the physical system also get the chance to work in normal way. Then we will be able to get rid of sickness. Today, more and more sicknesses appear because the human mind is very badly polluted. Tension, fear.
Thank you very much, most venerable sir. Thank you, panel. And so, brothers and sisters, I hope we have gained some kind of enlightenment on why religion. And we also hope that you now are beginning to see that Buddhism is not religion as it is defined in the dictionary, it's something more. It can help us in our life today. Now, we would like to invite you to listen to the next series in the series, and that is entitled, Why Buddhism? We've asked why religion. Now let's go on and ask why Buddhism. So stay with us. Greetings again, and welcome to the second part of our discussion on an introduction to Buddhism. As we mentioned earlier, this part is entitled, What is Buddhism? We may have heard lots of things about Buddhism, but we want to know what Buddhism really is. How is it practiced today? Who was the founder? Yeah, is this relevant? Is this knowledge relevant to us today? And let me now invite the first question. Mr. Tan Teck Beng, would you like to lead the discussion?
Okay. Mr. Brahman, nowadays many people talk about the Buddha, Buddhists as well as non-Buddhists. Who was the Buddha actually? Is he a historical figure? Was he God or man? And why do we worship him today?
All right. Yes, thank you. There are many interpretations given by the scholars, commentators, to introduce the Buddha. But the Buddha's own introduction is more important to us. How he introduced himself. One day when he was going somewhere, he met the follower of another religion. This man has never seen such serene person with good complexions and appealing to the mind. He believed that this person must be an extraordinary living being. He asked, may I know whether you are a god? Then the Buddha said, no, I am not a god. Then he asked, any other form of supernatural living being? Buddha says, no, I am very natural. Then are you an ordinary human being? He says, no, I am not an ordinary human being.
Then who are you? The Buddha gave the answer. It is mentioned in Pali, it's not necessary to mention the Pali language. He said,
understood are the things to be understood, cultivated are the things to be cultivated, eradicated are the things to be eradicated. Therefore, I am the Buddha. So this clearly shows how he gained his enlightenment without any divine inspiration, by using his own effort and energy and knowledge.
Therefore, I am the Buddha, neither God nor a supernatural human being nor an ordinary human being. Now we can understand who the Buddha is. Then the second part of your question is,
why do we worship?
Why do you worship the Buddha? In fact, the Buddha was not in favor of encouraging people to come and worship him. For example, when he was about to pass away, so many well-known personalities visited the place having heard the Buddha is going to pass away, carrying flowers to pay their respect. But Ananda, the disciple, approached the Buddha and informed, they have assembled to pay, offer flowers and worship. Then the Buddha said, you must go and tell them. If they really want to respect their master, instead of offering flowers and worshipping, ask them to go and practice at least one of the advices given by me. That is the highest way to pay respect or to worship the Buddha. On the other hand, we should not use the word worship. We do not worship the Buddha. It gives entirely different meaning. We pay homage. We honor him. We respect him. Not because he is a great man, not out of fear, but in appreciation of his highest achievement for gaining enlightenment, we honor him, we respect him.
Nevertheless, Venerable Sir, Buddhists, either for worshipping or for paying homage, do keep Buddha images in their homes or in the temples. What is the significance of this practice?
Yes. Human beings need some sort of religious object for them to concentrate or to pay respect, to recall either the God or the founder of a religion, so that they get more inspirations and devotions and confidence. Although the Buddha did not encourage anybody to erect an image of the Buddha, later the followers started to erect the Buddha image because they need of the Buddha, known as Vakkali, every day come and sit down in front of the Buddha, and he was gaining some sort of inspiration and happiness by watching his complexions and serenity and features. And the Buddha asked, Vakkali, what are you doing here? Then he said, I really admire your beauty. Then the Buddha said, what do you gain by watching this dirty, filthy, impermanent physical body? The Buddha is not in this physical body. Yo dhammam passati, so mam passati. One who sees the Dhamma taught by the Buddha. Through that Dharma, people can see the real Buddha. Now, the Buddha image that we worship today, we think this is the real figure, the feature of the Buddha. This is actually artist impression created to convince us, to create devotion. But we can recall the real Buddha into our mind when we understood what the Buddha taught, how he faced problem as an enlightened, holy, religious man, how he settled the problem, how he revealed the truth, and how he gave certain answer to certain subtle question, very convincing answers that he has given. Then we create the real image in our mind. That is the real Buddha. That is what the Buddha says. Through the Dhamma you can see the Buddha. Therefore, image is important to many people to develop that confidence. But today people worship and do some offerings by following the followers of other religions. Later they have learned all these things. So now we cannot go against them. If they gain some sort of confidence and devotion and faith by doing that, let them do, let them practice. But our duty is to enlighten them, not to think that is the only Buddhist way of life. This is our duty.
Jee Brother, thank you for your kind explanation. We have a very clear concept of what the Buddha, who is a great religious teacher, he is now. Anyway, would you kindly, I know to tell the whole teaching is very difficult in such a short span of time. Could you kindly tell us in brief what the Buddha taught?
Right. The main purpose of becoming the Buddha, to tell the people that they are suffering here in this world. At the same time, to tell them what is the cause of their suffering. At the same time, to tell them how to get rid of their worldly, physical and mental suffering.
He did not want to reveal everything in this universe as Buddhism. Then the problem is, people cannot understand what he really preached. After gaining his enlightenment, when he surveyed the world to understand the nature of the human mind, he realized human minds were deluded, clouded, misled, blindfolded. So it is very difficult for them to grasp, to understand what he realized. Again he said, this Dharma that I understood existed earlier. This is not a new Dharma. Patu rahosi magadesu pubbe. This Dharma existed long ago, but misinterpreted, polluted by people from time to time. Today, the real Dharma disappeared from the man's mind. Therefore, he did not want to introduce a religion. It is not religion. He wanted to introduce Dharma. The word Dharma is more meaningful than religion. Dharma means the method that which hold us, uphold, support us without allowing us to get into the unfortunate state of existence such as hells or animals or spirits or ghosts or devils or unfortunate state of existence. That system is called dharma. From religion we cannot get this meaning. So he wanted to introduce this dharma. But he had a very big battle. In fact, Indian historian says the Buddha has revolutionized the whole religious system in India because he did not follow the existing age-old religious belief and practices. And the dharma that they used also, he found out misled. That's why he had to start from the beginning. Because of this rational, meaningful, practical interpretations, the followers of other religions could not agree with the Buddha. That is why he had so many opponents who have gone against him. But he revealed the truth in this way. Very simple. Within three lines, he has introduced his 45 years teachings of the Dharma. Sabba papasya akarana, abstain from all evil deeds. Kusalasya upasampada, do good. Do good means do some service to others to relieve their sufferings and worries and problems. Sachitta pariyo dapana, try to train, try to purify your own mind. He used the word your own mind. It's very meaningful. Why? One person cannot purify another person's mind. Now I cannot purify your mind, but I can give some ideas for you to practice, to cultivate, to purify. I cannot make your life for you to get angry. I cannot create anger in your mind, but by taking some word or having seen certain thing that I am doing, you get angry. Then who created that anger? Not by me. You created the anger in your mind. So, the Buddha says, you must try to purify your own mind, means without depending on others. Before his passing away, his parting word, Attadipa bhikkhave viharatha atta sarana ananya sarana. You must try to develop your self-confidence. People have no confidence in them. That is their weakness. The Buddha tried to cultivate that confidence. That is why they always go and worship and pray and what you call take refuge in this God and that God and worship these hills and rocks and jungles and trees and idols and because they have no confidence. If they have confidence, all these activities are not important. Because that confidence completely give courage and knowledge and understanding for the human mind to face our problem, overcome our problem, to avoid our problem. Then he said, take refuge in you. Now we take refuge in the Buddha. The Buddha says, you take refuge in you. Don't take refuge in another person. That means your own self-confidence. That means by taking refuge in another person, you cannot gain your final salvation. Tummehi kichchang atappam akkhataro tathagata. Tathagata means Buddha can tell you what to do. But the Buddha cannot do for you to get rid of your suffering. So you have to work by following the guidance and instruction or the Dhamma taught by the Buddha, if you want to get rid of your suffering, by worshipping to the Buddha, by worshipping to God, by worshipping to and praying to God, the Buddha says you cannot get rid of your suffering unless you purify your own mind, unless you cultivate your own self-confidence.
I remember, Chief Reverend, you have said elsewhere that the doctor can give you the medicine, but you have to drink the medicine be cured. This is what you said some time ago.
Right.
Next question, please.
In your exposition just now, it seems that there's a lot of stress on the mind. For example, the Buddha's teaching is summarized into the three sentences: avoid evil, do good, and purify the mind. The last part, purify the mind, may not be found in other religions. But here in Buddhism, you have mentioned, we have to purify our mind, and it's all on our own. Now, how to purify our mind? Can you expand on this?
Yeah, this question is very important. All the other existing religions encourage people to develop faith and belief. Buddhism, or the Buddha, never encourage people to develop belief or faith, because faith and belief are going on changing according to knowledge, experience, maturity, understanding from time to time. He advised us to cultivate only confidence. Confidence we cannot create. We gain confidence naturally when we are convinced. According to our own conviction, we gain that confidence. Then, Buddhism says, whatever you do in the name of religion, it is impossible for you to find out final salvation. Salvation means liberation, freedom from suffering. Every religion uses the word salvation. That means they know very well, here we have no freedom. Physically and mentally we are suffering. So salvation means free from all these problems that we are facing today. But we also use the word salvation, liberation, deliverance or freedom. But according to the Buddha, we cannot gain this through faith and belief, only through the purifications of the mind. So Buddhism emphasizes only purity of the mind, not the belief or the faith. Then he introduced the method for that, how to purify the mind. That means through concentration, without allowing, without creating imaginations in your mind, allow your mind to relax, and one-pointedness to relax that mind, then the mind can bring back the lost energy that we have wasted during our lifetime through the senses. Then we rejuvenate, strengthen the mental energy. Then we gain more confidence, more courage and energy and wisdom, finally enlightenment and salvation.
The most venerable Nayaka Mahathera, I think we've come at a very critical and interesting point in our discussion on what Buddhism is all about. And today it is a fact of life that we live in a very materialistic world. On the one hand, we have been told to try and get as much as we can in this life, accumulate as much wealth, be successful in getting all kinds of successes in various endeavors. In this context of the materialistic civilization that we live in, what is the relevance of Buddhism? In other words, is Buddhism practicable in present-day modern context?
I think today this question is very important. There are some people who maintain that if we want to practice Buddhism, we must renounce the worldly life and keep away from all worldly enjoyment and lead isolated life without associating with society. This is entirely wrong. The Buddha started from the very beginning to build up our way of life. He said, as worldly people, you must have four kinds of happiness.
These four kinds of happiness are Atthisukha, Bhogasukha, Ananasukha, Anavajjasukha. By working very hard and whatever they have accumulated as their property gives them happiness to gain some confidence. Again, by experiencing some sort of sensual pleasure by using what they have earned also gives some sort of happiness if they use very reasonable way. Again, without borrowing anything from others, without depending on others, if they can manage within their means to maintain their life, that also gives happiness. Last one is anavajjasukha, blameless or harmless life gives happiness.
Again he says, arakka sampada, uttana sampada, don't be lazy. You must do something. After working according to your understanding, capacity, your knowledge, what you have learned, you can do something. Then what you have earned, again he says, you must know how to protect. Don't neglect. Then duties and responsibilities toward the family and the wife and the husband and children and relatives and the friends and the country and the nation and the government, all the duties he has mentioned. So he did not introduce meditation directly for people to go and practice Buddhism. After cultivating, having gone through these channels, when the more and more maturity, understanding appear in the mind, people come to know, after all, this life is just like a dream, nothing but dreams. Then they start to think very seriously. To make use of this life, to cultivate, to do some as a last, to mold, to shape the next existence if they want to prolong in the samsara. Because many people try to see the end of this cycle of birth and death, but it is not so easy. But those who want to stay for a long period, then they must prepare. Only human beings can do that. Even devas, brahmas, or any other living beings, animals cannot do that. This is the opportunity of becoming human being. While experiencing wonderful life, if we use our mind properly, we also can mold our next existence while we are living here. So, without fear, without worry, without confusion, because we have confidence that we have not wasted our life and we have not harmed others, then the next existence cannot become unfortunate one. Therefore, Buddhist contribution to the worldly life or the modern life, very practical. At the same time, they should not neglect that worldly life is permanent and eternal and must be changeable and unpredictable. Therefore, we must prepare for the final salvation also.
Can we get married and remain good Buddhists?
Well, the Buddha has said, it is a blessing if a man can find suitable partner for his marriage. And at the same time, if a woman can find a suitable partner for her marriage.
If Buddha goes against the marriage, how can he say like this? Again he says, these are the duties of the husband toward the wife. These are the duties of the wife toward the husband for their mutual understanding, peaceful coexistence. Then again, duties toward the children.
Yeah, I think, Chief Reverend, you have touched on the Buddhist views on our economic and material way of life. Now, there is another aspect which we the lay Buddhists always face, and that is the question of politics. Can we Buddhists participate in politics?
And to what extent?
How many Buddhist countries are there in this world today? Do you think they are not politicians? Let us take Thailand, nearly 94% Buddhist. Burma, also 95% Buddhist. Sri Lanka, 75% Buddhist. Thailand, Taiwan, they say 70% Buddhist. Japan, also they say at least 70% Buddhist. Do you think there's no Buddhist politics in there? The Buddha has given guidance, advices to rajas and the rulers and politicians how to rule the country. In fact, he has said, the ruler who does not punish a culprit is not suitable to remain as a ruler. That is his duty. On the other hand, he says, ruler who punish innocent person also not suitable to remain as a ruler. So he has pointed out so many weaknesses among the rulers. They had to approach the Buddha to gain his blessings and guidance. So what is the meaning of politics? What is the purpose of politics? Usually people say politics is dirty. Religion is irreligious. Human beings are unreliable. These are the common belief. All these things created by the human mind. We have polluted politics. We have polluted religion. We have polluted human life. That is why the purity of the mind is important, so that Buddhists can do very well with politics.
Chief Reverend, one question. Nowadays, people are very busy in this materialistic world. Now, we have already listened to Chief's enlightenment to us what Buddhism is. Now, how do we as Buddhist leaders, how can we impart in a very simple and better way to begin making our these people
I think it is very simple. If you can live without harming others, you are a first-class Buddhist. No need to go beyond that. To live without harming others, you have to cultivate so many things. You have to develop your mind, your words, your actions, then all the duties are there.
See, Prabhupada, often we stress in Buddhism, say, anger, ill will, and hatred. These are the three roots.
No.
Only happens in
ignorance.
Human being. Three roots of poison. And then we will develop sila, samadhi, and panya, so that we can overcome these three evil
roots.
Would you kindly enlighten us more about this?
Three main roots of the evil: lobha, dosa, moha. Selfish craving, hatred, and illusions or ignorance. So, any of our evil thought, word, actions related to one of these three roots, evils. Attainment of arahanthood or sainthood or perfection means uprooting these three roots. from the mind. Then that person becomes perfect human being who cannot commit any evil. Impossible to commit any evil because no evil roots in the mind. To cultivate this mind, to get rid of these three evil roots, the first thing we had to develop is contentment. Santutti paramang dhana. In the Buddha's teaching, he said, paramang dhana, highest wealth for us is the contentment. When we cultivate this contentment in our mind, jealousy never appears because we are contented. Anger followed by jealousy. Then if no anger, no violence, no bloodshed. So very easily we can control all the evil thought, words, action by cultivating contentment. Then what is contentment? Some people think contentment means just to lead a lazy life without doing anything. No. We have to work very hard, according to the Buddha. But after gaining enough material things, requisites that we need, yeah, this is enough for us, or for me, or for my family. That is called contentment. After that, jealousy never appears in that mind. I am content. I am satisfied. I have no jealousy when others enjoy their life. I never get angry. So that is the first thing we have to cultivate, contentment. Naturally, even without our knowledge, certain evil thoughts disappear from the mind when the contentment is there. Now that is the solution.
Thank you very much, Reverend Sir. Just as we are getting right into it, I think we are running out of time. But brothers and sisters, we never promised all the answers. The Buddha took 45 years to explain all the questions that were put at him. What we hope to do is to have whetted your interest that Buddhism is not a religion that is simply to be cast aside. We hope you will now take the trouble to go deeper into these. There's lots of books. Chief Reverend is always there to answer your questions. You can write, you can phone, you can come visit the temples. And so the opportunity is there for you. Don't lose it. Thank you. Greetings again and welcome to the third session of our discussion on an introduction to Buddhism. As I told you in the last session, this session is called Buddhist Practices and Beliefs. And once again, we will be asking questions on your behalf of our most venerable chief, who will elucidate these problems for us. And so, without further ado, can I call upon somebody? Chu Hong Min? Yeah.
Yes, Venerable Sir. Beliefs and practices. There are many beliefs and practices in Buddhism which are not in congruence with the teachings of the Lord Buddha. So much so that one author remarked that Buddhism is the most paradoxical of all religions. For example, on the one hand, we teach compassion and dana or generosity. But on the other hand, in actual practice, Buddhism contributed very little to welfare work. On one hand, for example, we teach, Buddhism taught us to do good, avoid evils, and purify the mind, to learn the religion, to practice the religion. But in practice, we prefer to kneel down and bend our heads and pray for something or some kind of miracles and things like that. So much so that people say to we Buddhists do a lot of meaningless things. So I would like to hear some comments on this.
Yes. It is not so easy to answer these questions because people have traditional practices that they maintained for thousands of years. When Buddhism started to develop from country to country, people have incorporated those existing traditional belief and practices into Buddhism. Even then, if they maintain certain Buddhist concept, Buddhist attitude, Buddhist way of life, it is natural. But more Buddhists in Asian countries concentrate more on rites and rituals and ceremonies. They are used to practice religion in this way of life. But in the West, people are not interested in rites and rituals and ceremonies, but they are interested to learn more philosophy and psychology and meditation. The thing is this, we have to consider how long that religion can last if they have not incorporated religion into their culture, into their tradition and into their way of life. Later, Buddhism can become very dry subject if depend on philosophy or psychology or meditation. That is why people have mixed up these together to carry on their culture, their tradition and their religious way of life. On the other hand, Buddhism is very tolerant religion. People have taken advantage of this tolerance to add any kind of practices and perform as Buddhist practices. The Buddha's advice is this: if your traditional practices are meaningful, useful, harmless, you can carry on, you can practice. If they are meaningless, give up. Don't try to justify saying this is our tradition, this is our custom. Meaningless. Then, what people are doing or practicing in this part of the world? Now let us take Buddhist funeral rites. Many things that they perform have become mockery in the eyes of intellectuals and the followers of other religions. But we try to justify, this is our tradition, this is our custom, we have to pay respect to our departed one in this manner. What we have to do, we have to clarify this. This is our traditions and customs and culture. This is Buddhism. When we point out separately these two things, then there won't be misunderstanding. Otherwise, when you observe very carefully a Chinese funeral rites, you can see there are many un-Buddhistic, like slaughtering animals and offerings. But many people think Buddhism encourages people to practice this kind of thing. Then how can you say you are observing non-violence and kindness and compassion? And wasting so much money for unnecessary things, for burning. So this Buddhism never encourages for these practices. But if you can explain to others, these are our traditional practices, and although Buddhism does not encourage, we perform this thing, but there are many who understood, who had the courage to give up so many unnecessary practices. Time has come for people to minimize as much as possible those unnecessary religious rites and rituals, because it is mentioned in the Buddha's teaching, to attain the first stage of sainthood, Sotapanna, we have to eradicate our attachment toward rites and rituals and ceremonies by thinking through these practices we can find our salvation. Therefore, these things can become hindrance instead of supporting for us to lead the Buddhist way of life.
Unfortunately, I think that we Buddhist organizations also encourage a lot of rites and rituals. Some Buddhist organizations organize activities with plenty of rites and rituals.
But isn't ceremony necessary for institutionalized religion?
Ceremonies are important for those who have not studied Buddhism. Let us take, for instance, children who have not learned anything, who cannot understand anything. Whenever there is something like lion dance, dragon dance, ceremonies, processions, thousands and thousands of assemble. Later, through the influence of these ceremonies, they get into religious way of life. Otherwise, they can keep away from religion.
See, Reverend, you've been talking so much about rites and ritual and your relationship with religion. I beg your indulgence to elaborate a bit further, because men in the street actually not very clear about rites and ritual and their relationship with religion, especially at the time of the birth, marriage and at death. A lot of ceremonies take place. So how can Buddhism satisfy these needs?
This question is very important to find out what happened to Buddhism in India. From time to time, there were so many aggressive rulers who tried to destroy Buddhism. They have done a lot of damages, massacred millions of Buddhists and monks and destroyed temples. Later, foreign invaders occupied India. They have attacked and destroyed and burned temples, pagodas, libraries, not only Buddhism, Hinduism, Jainism and Brahminism and various other isms. Later, all the others slowly developed their religious way of life, but Buddhism completely disappeared from India for 700 years. The main reason is those Buddhists, especially Buddhist scholars and the monks, who tried to introduce Buddhism, they have devoted their time, most of their time, for philosophy, psychology, and metaphysical subject, and which ordinary people cannot understand, not useful for their day-to-day life. They have not contributed many things for people to maintain as Buddhist way of life in their day-to-day life. I don't think they ever had a funeral rite according to Buddhist religion at that time. After birth, there was no such ceremonies or blessings, and weddings according to other religions they had. Birth, wedding, death. On these three occasions, all the other existing religion paid more attention to give blessings and advices, but Buddhism ignored these three occasions. That attitude has become the main cause of the downfall of Buddhism in India. When I came to this country 43 years ago, I have not seen any new couples who even come to the temple to receive the blessings during their wedding. But later, it has taken some time for us to encourage and explain why the blessing is necessary in that special occasion. Now, government has recognized and given full authority for Buddhists and other religionists to perform marriage and issue the certificate. After that, many people who have never visited the temple started to visit the temple. Then they get used to the place, then they learn religion, then they feel that there is some sort of connection, communication, relationship with the temple and the monks and the members. Therefore, it is very important to introduce those three occasions: birth, wedding and funeral.
Most Venerable Nayaka Mahathera, at the beginning of our discussion, we had talked about worship and worshipping as important elements of religion. And another important element or ingredient of religion is the concept of God. Now, in terms of the Buddhist perspective, what is the relevance of worship or worshipping in terms of Buddhist practice? How important it is and what place does it have? And in terms of the concept of God, what is the Buddhist thinking attitude on the concept of God?
Can I just add to that and ask rituals? What part do rituals play in this worship?
I think I can explain later.
Yes.
Okay. Attend to the first question. Earlier, I have mentioned difference between worshipping and paying homage. People worship somebody or God because of fear, or thinking that person is very powerful to gain something, that is worshipping. Paying homage or paying respect is to honor that person in appreciation of wisdom or holiness or sacredness or enlightenment. Then that is called paying respect. So we do not worship the Buddha asking any worldly favors, but we respect, we homage, appreciation of the achievement, and also gain more confidence and inspiration to follow his footsteps, to attain, to gain the same enlightenment. That is the meaning of paying respect and paying homage. Then, the concept of God. Every existing religion in this world depends on God. Take for instance, when they want to introduce a good person, you say, he's a God-fearing man. That means a good man. So without God, there is no religion. So many people want to know what is the Buddhist attitude. Some people say Buddhists do not believe in God. Some others say Buddhists also believe in God. This question was put to the Buddha. I have mentioned this in my book, The Treasure of the Dhamma, you can see. The disciples of the Buddha asked this question: have we got any evidence to prove the existence of gods? Simple G, not capital G. Existence of gods. The Buddha gave very strange answer. He asked, what have we got to prove that gods do not exist? So that really shows he did not deny the existence of gods. why he gave the answer in that way? Although God exists, it is not very important for us, not compulsory for us to believe, to find out our salvation. For example, I always give this parable. Those who believe in God for their protection, every day they pray and worship, but if they do not lock their door when they go out station, there is no guarantee that God will protect the house until they come back. That means, as Buddhists, whether we believe in God is not the most important thing. We should not say that we don't believe in God. Not necessary to say. We can create more misunderstanding. A well-known intellectual, Krishnamurti, he had no particular religion. He says, those who shout that we believe in God, and another group shout we don't believe in God, he says both are in the same boat. Those who say that they believe in God do not know anything about God, just say they believe in God. And those who say they do not believe in God also do not know anything about God, simply say we don't believe. The Buddhist attitude should be, again, Krishnamurti says, those who are free from this group, those who are neutral, can understand who the God is. So the Buddha's advice is, whether the God exists or not, you should not neglect your duties, your responsibilities for your own salvation. That means without depending on God, without depending on the Buddha, you had to work for your own salvation. But we had to depend on others, humans or gods also, for certain worldly, day-to-day material things. This is the Buddhist concept. Now we can say we don't believe in God, but our concept of God is different.
So we don't want to waste time.
We have no time to waste.
My question now.
Yes.
How do we, can you advise us on what is the best way to practice some simple rituals
now,
which are meaningful?
Certain rites and rituals that we perform in the temples are not belong to the rites and rituals aspect, because they are very meaningful. Offering flowers, light, incense gives wonderful meaning. We had to convert this offering for meditation. When you offer flowers in honor of the Buddha, puppam milayati yatha idam me kayo tatha yati vinasaba. These flowers are so beautiful, very lovely, nice smell. But after one or two days, they fade away and dirty and smelly. My body also sometimes exactly turn into this flower, decay and disappear. The light I offer to illuminate the whole area, to dispel the darkness, I can develop my mind to illuminate the ignorance, to illuminate the mind, to wipe out the ignorance, to dispel the darkness of the ignorance through these offerings of light. Incense purify the atmosphere and recall the mind, the religious way of practices through that feeling. So these things are not under the rites and rituals. All are meaningful practices. We do not waste anything, and we do not harm any living being. We do not mislead anybody. These are meaningful practices. Besides these practices, we have so many unnecessary, meaningless rites and for generations introduced by our ancestors, when the educations and understanding were not there in their mind to what happened to our life, what is the nature of birth and death. Just because of the fear that they have created in the mind, they introduce certain practices to get rid of such evil forces. But still people follow these things. The time has come for us to minimize all these practices as much as possible, because today people are educated.
Chief Reverend, when we watch Sri Lankan, Burmese, Thai and Chinese Buddhists carry out certain Buddhist practices, they seem very difficult and elaborate to perform. Some Western educated professionals, when they watch this, they find that it is very embarrassing for them to perform. Do you think a person who does not perform these activities is considered a bad Buddhist?
To answer your question, I think we had to consider very carefully, because Buddhism is a universal religion. The Buddha did not introduce a religion for people to practice according to traditional practices or belief in one particular country. When you study how Buddhism spread and existed for the last 2,500 years in various countries, we can understand people have incorporated their cultural, traditional practices into Buddhism. Although people say that they are Buddhist practices, actually, the Buddha has not introduced any kinds of religious rites and rituals and ceremonies. But the devotees have incorporated those practices in various countries according to their cultural and traditional practices. Therefore, we must understand the difference between Buddhism and Buddhist practices. Let us start from the very beginning. In Asian countries, people pay more attention towards cultural and traditional practice. And philosophy, psychology, and mental training, they consider later. First start with traditional and cultural practices to influence the masses. Those uneducated people also pay more attention when they introduce religious practices through their cultural practices and belief, because they respect their own culture as their cultural heritage. Then, after introducing Buddhist way of life and the teachings, they introduce the intellectual aspect. All are not intellectuals. It takes time for people to understand the deeper aspect of the teachings of the Buddha. But when we go through various practices earlier, they get used to Buddhist way of life, and very easily
they create the background in their mind to understand the teachings and the Buddhist way of life. Then slowly, they try to gain better knowledge and understanding as the real teachings of the Buddha in order to practice Buddhism in a proper manner as taught by the Buddha. Just now you mentioned Western educated people sometimes regard us as bad Buddhists. But we should not listen to the Westerners or Western educated people that they are true, because their cultural background, their way of life, their education, when you compare with the Asiatic way of life, there are a lot of differences. Therefore, we should not follow them blindly, although they are very intelligent. There are many things that we have to learn from them, but we should not follow them blindly, saying Westerners do not agree with our way of life. So we have to respect our own culture, our own tradition, because in the Buddha's teaching also it is mentioned that we can pay respect to our own culture if they are harmless. Therefore, Buddhism is a very liberal religion, and we can practice this religion without disturbing or disappointing others by giving due credit to their cultural and traditional practices.
Most Venerable Chief Reverend, I'm delighted that you had pinpointed on the practice of Buddhism, meaning the prescriptive aspect of Buddhism rather than just the cognitive aspect of it. But at the same time, unfortunately, because there is this concept of samsara, there's a concept of karma, many people have labeled Buddhism as something which promotes inertia, because everybody will sit down and say, well, it's because of karma this has happened, there's nothing I can do. So they are resigned to a way of life, they are resigned to face their pitfalls, their shortcomings, their failures, and then, you know, sort of not provide them the energies, the attitude to try and develop themselves. So I would be very much enlightened if you could try and give some focus to this particular dilemma in Buddhist societies, which is a fact in quarters who do not really recognize the prescriptive aspect of Buddhism.
I think this is also another important question. Not only Buddhists, followers of many religions, we have noticed, whenever they are facing certain problems and troubles, they say, what to do, it is up to him, up to the will of God. We cannot do anything. And the followers of some other religions say, oh, we cannot do anything, this is due to our own karma. They keep quiet. The Buddha did not encourage this. He has advised us not to surrender yourself to your own karma. By using your effort, your energy, your intelligence, your understanding, you can overcome the bad effect of certain bad karma that you have committed. So therefore, simply by keeping quiet, oh, it is due to our karma, we can't do anything, Buddhism never support. Again, there is a beautiful saying in Sanskrit language, Udyoginan Purisa Simham Paiti Lakshmi. Those who use their effort and knowledge and energy and wisdom to overcome their problems and difficulties and to achieve something without depending on their God, their karma, their fate, their fortune, their human lion, Purusha Singha, their human lion, great heroes who work by using effort, knowledge, understanding, and wisdom. without surrendering their religious life.
This third karma is not understood by many people.
Yes.
Can you enlighten us on that?
Of course, karma is not belong to any particular religion. People can say we don't believe in karma. Karma is natural. Action creates some sort of reactions or the effect, good and bad. That is called karma. When that action involved with immoral practices, we introduce this as bad karma. When this action involved with good intention, it's called good karma. Good karma and bad karma are based on these moral and immoral. Neutral karmas have no effect for us to carry forward. Immediate effect we face in our day-to-day life. Neutral karmas which are not belong to moral or immoral. Now, by using our effort, we can overcome the bad effect of our bad karma life after life by cultivating, developing more and more good karma. If we keep quiet without developing this, then we have to face, either within this lifetime or hereafter at any time, as long as we exist in this world. So the karmic effects are natural. Now, electricity. If people do not know how to handle carefully, although people advise them to be careful, if they neglect, they may get electric shock. Action and reaction both are there. So in between this action and reaction, there is no God, there is no devil, there is no Buddha. This is the nature of karma, action and reaction. It is natural.
Venerable sir, I'd like to slightly move away from this and ask you another question. All of us who are involved with Buddhist organizations, we are always faced with this problem of not having enough monks. Could you please advise us on how, what we should do? Because this is a real problem. And we are used to this idea that our religious life must be led by venerable monks who are not forthcoming. What do we do?
Well, in Burma, there are 500,000. In Thailand, there are more than 300,000. In Sri Lanka, about 30,000. In Malaysia, we have got enough two or three monks in one temple. In certain temple, not even one monk. Chinese concept, Chinese belief, traditional belief is responsible for that. Because they have four major traditional practices. One of them is to maintain their family lineage, family name. They should not break that lineage. After becoming a monk, by keeping away from married life, if they do not produce children, they break this reading. I remember a young boy who wanted to become a monk. But we told him we cannot do that without consent of the parent. Somehow or the other, he came with his father. Then the father said, "I object, I don't like." Then the son said, "If you don't allow me to become a monk, I'll become a drug addict. If not, I become a gangster." The father said, "I don't mind. But I don't want you to become a monk because of that family." Now you can understand, this traditional belief really Every year when we organize our novitiate program, at least 4 or 5 young boys like to remain in the robe, but the parents say no, cannot. Objection always comes from the parents. It's very difficult for us to educate those people because of this traditional belief. So, on the other hand, people also must learn to perform their religious practices also without depending on many monks. They say they want 3 monks, they want 5 monks, they want 2 monks. At least one monk is more than enough. And some people say they want only this particular monk. And that is, you know, the Buddhist attitude. So, they can perform many religious activities even without depending on monks. But for certain practices, monks are very important, because ordinary lay devotees cannot create that confidence in their mind to gain some sort of satisfaction. For that, monks are important. So it is not so easy. And the government attitude is, without depending on foreign missionaries, to train local people. So we cannot argue with the government. But when we say local people are not interested, then the government says, then what can we do for them? It is your duty to train local people. So somehow or the other, we must try to introduce, educate our elders the value of this contribution and services that they can render. Family also get the blessing if they can allow one of their boys to enter into the sasana, to serve the sasana and to promote Buddhism, to introduce Buddhism.
Thank you. Last question.
I think apart from the belief of maintaining the family tradition or the family lineage, another reason could be due to some negative ideas about monks or the Sangha. Perhaps you can enlighten us on the positive role played by the monks or the Sangha in our society.
Well, Triple Gem in Buddhism, just like Trinity in Christianity, the Buddha, the Dhamma, and the Sangha. The Buddha is just like a doctor who can diagnose the sickness and prescribe the medicine. So that prescription given by the Buddha is the Dhamma. And the patients in the hospital mostly depend on nurses. Nurses are just like monks. They are the ones who guide them, advise them, provide proper food and medicine at proper time, and all the necessary instruction, guidance given by the nurses. So the Buddha, Dhamma, Sangha, just like doctor and the medicines and the nurses. So these services are more than enough for the monks to serve whole mankind, to guide them.
Some people have the misconception that monks actually do nothing, non-productive people. So what is your comment on
that? Yes, there are some. Do a lot of service by doing nothing. Let us take a hen who lays eggs, sit down quietly without doing anything, but after that produce chickens. But those who run here and there cannot produce anything. Those who keep quiet without doing anything, they can concentrate, they can train the mind, they develop more discipline, they don't do any harm. So much the better. But they too have lot of duties. The Buddha has mentioned in his teaching, duties toward the devotees and duties toward the monk, our relationship. So monks must fulfill their duties toward the lay people, the lay followers. Devotees must fulfill their duties toward the monks to maintain them. So when they develop this relationship, we can maintain very healthy attitude and carry on our activities with understanding.
Thank you very much, Reverend Sir. I think this is a very nice point at which to end. Brothers and sisters, as you know, this is the third of the series, Introduction to Buddhism. Now, we must emphasize it's only an introduction to Buddhism. It is not a comprehensive survey of Buddhism. Many questions need to be asked. Chief Venerable spoke about karma. That's a whole topic in itself. We haven't even touched nirvana. We've got so much ground to cover. But we hope, and there's always been our hope, that this series will interest you, will introduce you to that great religion which we human beings have inherited. I think it is my duty now to thank the members of the panel, Ng Hong Pao, Tan Teck Beng, Dato, and Brother Ang Chu Hong for having spent this time with us and asked questions on your behalf. Of course, these questions would never have been answered, and answered so brilliantly and so lucidly and so relevantly, if it had not been for our most venerable chief. And of course, our chief, as he said, is the nurse. Let us not ever forget where it all began, with our enlightened master, the Buddha himself. So with this, I say to all of you, sadhu, sadhu, sadhu.
Sadhu, sadhu, sadhu.